Heaven Blues Channel presents Paranormal, Book 9, Part 6, and the Finale. Legend of the Pharaoh's Curse by Dr. Ahmed Khalid Tawfiq. And please, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel. Are you going to open it now? Asked my assistant while looking with interest at the two Kanubi vessels, as if this fool was speaking about a vessel containing expensive chocolate. I did not respond to him harshly because I was busy checking the inscriptions, looking for that particular symbol. Yes, here it is again. The one with deep-seated evil inside him will spread horror, etc., etc. Truth be said, Amun's priests did not leave a chance for anyone to say he did not read the warnings. They fulfilled their duty meticulously, and whoever ignored these warnings afterward were personally responsible for doing so. Will we open it now? He repeated insistently. Maybe it would be better to await that ghost hunter doctor's opinion. But he is just a phony who has no idea about pharaonic history, he said disgustedly. Without being convinced of what I was saying, I responded, He's not so bad. Plus, he is rather unfazed and unafraid of these things. Yeah, because he doesn't know what we know. Interested, I looked at him and repeated his sentence, thinking, Yes, he doesn't know what we know. But what do we know? And here, the candle flickered from our breath as I sat with my wife in front of the small cake she had baked for our humble party. Our 10th year. No kids, no important milestones, but we are happy. And the candle of love is still lit. True, it's no longer that old volcanic fire, but has become a calm, steady flame giving us warmth and content. Gently, my little love whispered, though she was now 40 years old, You're not bored with me yet? When the flowers get bored by the visit of the spring, I will get bored with you. She responded, But I didn't give you any children. The sun does not give birth to sons. I didn't, she started. Damn, the ringing of the phone penetrated my last nerve. Hurrying to pick it up, I was convinced that this time there was a catastrophe. Muhammad Raghab is dead. For a moment, I didn't know what to do or say, but then swallowed hard, saying, Who's speaking? What a question. It's General Murad, of course. And who died again? Muhammad Raghab, 2 hours ago. And he began relating the whole story, which, of course, ended with how the wife took the kids for an outing and stated that he was perfectly healthy, did not complain of tiredness, did not ask for a glass of water, as those who are dying usually do. Instead, she left him in front of the TV, watching and cracking up at an Ismail Yassin movie. And when she came back, he was still sitting in the same chair, in the same position, staring curiously at a boring scene about Zambia's economy in the 1960s, which raised her suspicion. And when she examined his status carefully, she realized he was no longer in our world. And it's foolish to assume that he died of boredom or hatred of Zambia. The Pharaoh had moved for a second time, but at an abnormal speed, a speed we never expected. This young man was amongst us this morning, blabbering about Akhirum and assisting Dr. Rifat in the mummy's autopsy. And the latter would assure me that Raghab's fainting was not a portent of his death, and would speak to me about the vasovagal reflex and use a few Latin medical terms about which I had no clue. And I wouldn't dare at that time accuse him of a lack of intelligence. But about Dr. Rifat, is he okay? I know he lives alone, which makes him easy prey. Plus, he is the number one candidate on our list for leaving this world next. Dialing the phone like a madman, I waited but only heard the sound of ringing echoing in his empty apartment. I had forgotten he was with his fiancée, whom I didn't know lived in Alexandria. Thus, I kept dialing the number. 9 p.m. 10. 11. And here, I remembered. There was a third person at the top of our list. True, he did not disturb the Pharaoh's rest, but how could I know that Akhirum was fair to that extent? I dialed Nader's number and waited with worry for a few seconds until I heard his throaty voice answering. Horrified, I said, Nader, Mr. Raghab is dead. Don't stay alone. Please, don't stay alone. By far more horrified than me, he replied. Dr. Ramsay, there are things I don't understand. Yes, yes, all of this is mysterious. I'm talking about the film I shot. Is it ruined? No, but it shows some weird things, he said with a shaky voice. Very weird things. 9. We have to move. I'll look at the film tomorrow, Natter. In the meantime, don't forget my advice. When I returned to my wife, she was fast asleep as the night had been totally ruined, and our mood was ruined for several generations. I will call Dr. Riffat again during the day. As for now, I'll get some sleep. Remind me to buy some rat poison tomorrow, as the sound of their claws against the latch on the window shutters. Huge mice, apparently. I'll take care of it in the morning. As for now, I'm exhausted. So tired. At around 10 a.m., Dr. Riffat responded to my repetitive phone calls. I cordially told him what had happened the night before. I gave him the same advice I had given Nader. But with pride, he said, "Caution does not prevent fate." He didn't elaborate further, but I don't blame him, and I understand, to a certain degree, how he feels. When being threatened by danger, calling the cops, or owning a gun, or keeping a dog, or barricading your windows is useless against it. Isn't that terrifying? By the way, speaking of windows, you forgot to remind me to check the shutters, so I hope the mice didn't chew through part of it. The bedroom overlooked a balcony attached to the other room, which opened onto it with French doors. The balcony, strung with onions, hung from several nails, as in any Egyptian home which respects itself, and a couple of huge pots filled with honey sent by my relatives in Upper Egypt. Thus, it seems strange for mice to attack a window surrounded by onions, as it's known that the smell of onions repels them. Even so, honey and onions? Where do those two things gather? In my balcony, of course. And where else? And here the answer came to my head, giving me a sort of electric shock. Get out, you who come in the dark and enter sneakily. This is how they would protect the child, with this spell attributed to Isis. I have sheltered him from you with the onions which harm you, and with the honey which tastes sweet in the living's mouth and bitter in the mouth of the dead. That's the solution. It wasn't mice messing with my window, but something else. Something repelled by onions and honey. Something the pharaohs spoke of and used to shield their children. That thing tried to force itself into my room. And I was shaken. Well then, I have taken my place on the list. Me, who touched nothing and did not appear on the film. But why? At Nader's place, we sat watching the film he shot of Dr. Riffat and the late Mohammed Raghab as they autopsied the mummy. The scenes rolled by as Nader explained each scene, as the lighting was insufficient and he was unaccustomed to using a handheld video cam. Therefore, his hand was shaking, shaking to the point that the pictures almost blinded me. That's enough, Nader. Patience, he said, as here you see him removing the layers of wrappings. And here I was mesmerized. Here and there, scores of small suns lighting the screen, and Dr. Riffat picking up a few and placing them in a small paper, Raghab taking some of them and rubbing them between his fingers, then the two of them talking and Mohammed Raghab falling. And we entered. The scene flickered, and then darkness filled the screen and the movie ended, only the whirring of the camera's motor. What are these shiny particles? I asked Nader with surprise. Returning the film to its box, he replied, They're very tiny crystals they found, not knowing what they are. Weird thing is, they were totally inert in this setting, but after the filming... I don't understand. Well, they are radiant with special elements picked up on the film, but undetectable by the Geiger counter, he explained. And do they rather resemble particles of sugar? Kind of, he said. But what is it? I've never seen anything like it. Neither have I, but we went in and tried to help Raghab. So those particles stuck to our clothes like grains of wheat, and Riffat must have picked up his share of them as well. Confidently, Natter replied, but he didn't touch them. He gathered a few of them in a small paper. And where did he put that? He stuffed it into his pack of cigarettes. And you? I prompted. I wasn't standing near them the whole time. And here I understood. Ahiram had used a complicated method, like the method banks use in identifying robbers, with a permanent colored ink placed on some of the intended loot. Whoever opens the grave pollutes himself with these particles, and thus becomes a clear and specified target. Of whom? Of the devilish guardian of the tomb, of course. I must warn Riffat, as God only knows where he put his pack of cigarettes. As for my problem, it's far more complicated. My wife had found the crystals on my suit, clearing them with the brush, and they spread about on the carpet and everywhere, which means it's impossible to get rid of this hunting devil. I have to leave my apartment. Anyway, as a first step, I will tell Riffat. I dialed his number several times, with no use. This man doesn't enter his home except to leave it again. I tried again and again, while my wife regarded me silently. And she became convinced of my insanity when I grabbed her arm to take her to her brother's place. Going up the stairs, she said, "He will think you kicked me out." A kicked-out wife is better than a dead wife. "I don't understand," she said. "Well, who does?" I then drove to my office. The time was nearing 11 p.m. when I entered, followed by the surprised guard. Sitting at my desk, I called an important official within the Antiquities Authority and told him the full story, and there's no reason to say he considered me crazy. "And what do you want?" he prompted. "To burn the Kanubi vessels and rebury the mummy." "And is that enough?" "It's the only solution I know." "Let me study the matter," he said. "As you know, it's Friday, and..." Friday was not a holiday for the pharaohs, and nothing will stop the guardian of the tomb from killing us all on a Friday. "Well, let me think about it for a couple hours." Putting down the phone, I contemplated my fingernails, and then I dialed Dr. Riffat's number. This time he picked up the phone, and I knew he was an Alex, once again, in a single day. So I asked him to come immediately to my office. "And why?" he asked. "Not to play chess, of course. This is a dangerous matter." And when Riffat arrived, accompanied by the stench of his cigarettes, we sat for about an hour exchanging our experiences. The pieces of the picture were starting to gather, and it represented the sneering, red-eyed Ahiram insistent upon eliminating his opponents. Riffat now understood that scene which confused him the night before in the theater. There was something watching him, and that thing was not an illusion. And I was surprised by Riffat, knowing he did not believe in myths, but rather sees a scientific explanation at the basis of every myth. The ancients once thought that lightning was the devil's clothing, but it turned out to simply be the discharge of electricity. And the scientists believe in werewolves, not believing it was the disease porphyria. But Riffat admitted believing some of the myths, like the Loch Ness Monster, and the Assess, the demonic night watchman. And, maybe, this myth we are currently facing. And he had a measurement from which he would not deviate. Everything that contradicts, firstly, with religion, and secondly, with science, is a myth. And since this science was in its infancy, then whatever contradicts with science but is accepted in religion, for example, the envious eye and black magic, exists as a probability, for which science may one day find a solution as knowledge advances. Therefore, because our case concerned black magic, Dr. Riffat was willing to discuss, test, and be convinced of it, if he didn't find another way to explain it. Whereas the myths of Dracula, zombies, and Medusa found nothing but refusal from him, as they obviously contradicted with religion. His thinking is logical. And I think I would have liked this man if he were better looking, less sarcastic, and smoked less heavily. Anyway, I reached my hand toward him, asking, "Do you still have the paper?" "What paper?" "The one in which you placed the crystals, the track which the guard of the tomb is following." Casually, he said, Sure, I put it in my pack of cigarettes. And where is that? He seemed confused and started rifling through his pockets. It would be a disaster if he threw it in the trash, as always happens. I'm sure he did so. Then, frowning, he wiped the sweat from his glasses and said, Just a second. I had it yesterday, in the cafeteria, and... Then he bit his lower lip, saying, Yes, yes, I remember. Hueda took it from me to prevent me from smoking. Oh my God. Tensely, he rose and signs of understanding showed on his face as he said, I understand. That's why she had a horrible experience with that ghost that haunted her last night. The miserable girl was carrying her death sentence in her purse and didn't know. Pointing to the phone, I said imploringly, Well then, call her immediately. Of course, I won't describe to you our lame efforts at reaching Alexandria. Scores of failed trials until we heard the long ringing, and heard the phone being answered as Rifat screamed frantically, Hueda, is my pack of cigarettes still in your purse? She responded with a scream, uttering incomprehensible words. So Rifat then shouted, Get rid of the pack immediately. Throw it from the window. There's no time to explain. She replied with something that distorted Rifat's features, and he asked, wondering, With whom? Not receiving a reply, he repeated frantically, With whom, Hueda? With whom? Curious, I drew closer to him, asking, What's happening? And looking at me with unseeing eyes, he said, He's there, in her room. Jumping to the phone like someone stung, I took it from him and screamed, Listen to me, miss. And then, Huh? Yes, of course I want an extension on the call, damn you. No, no, that wasn't directed to you, miss. I was talking to the operator. Now, listen to me. Get some honey and some onions from the kitchen. No, I'm not crazy. Hurry. My shouting seemingly brought her back to her senses, and I heard her running. And I heard a strange sound like that of a door being smashed. Then I heard her picking up the phone, saying breathlessly, I have them. I have them. Okay, then drip the honey in a circle and then stand inside it, with whoever is with you, holding the onions in your hands. Hurry! And recite any Quranic verses you know by heart. Come on, come on! I heard noises, and the voice of a man speaking, and the rustling of the onions, and I screamed once again. Put the phone to your ear, and drag the phone to the center of the circle so I know what's happening. Huh? Yes, yes, another extension, you idiot! The sound of wood breaking, sweat gathering on my forehead, and Rifat staring at me like a lost child. The sound of screams, a sound like a lion's roar, the sound of bullets being fired, and then silence. After a few moments, I heard a man's voice saying breathlessly, It's over. It's gone. Oh, thank God. But who are you? He asked, and what's the meaning of all this? It's a long story, and Dr. Rifat will give you the details. And Rifat took the phone from me and asked eagerly, Are you all okay? How is Hueda? It was a long night, Adil. Really long. And he told him everything. The ending, as told by Dr. Rifat Ismail. This was the only way Dr. Ramsey's brain could figure it. Here we were standing at the opening of the huge furnace at the iron and metal works, which the authorities evacuated in preparation for what we were about to do. Dr. Ramsey carried the two Kanubi vessels belonging to the pharaoh whom we called Ahiram I, waiting on a sign from the engineer. Now, the engineer said firmly. And at that point, Dr. Ramsey threw them in the furnace, into the raging flames reaching temperatures of 1500 degrees, and he stepped aside, and we did the same. Was that the sound of a long, heinous shriek coming from hell? Were those flaming tongues taking the shape of a tortured ghost? Was that red light the light of the end? I don't know, but we kept staring at the fire, the huge fire which melted any trace of that evil entity, the entity which stayed asleep in the vessels, inside the guts of Ahiram, awaiting anyone who desecrates the grave and sticking the crystals to them so as to come out and hunt them, and bring them a heinous death after leaving an eternal print of horror on their features. The one with deep-seated evil inside him will spread horror in the hearts of the intruders. And it did. But we have destroyed his guts. So did the evil die with it? Dr. Ramsay left nothing to chance. Thus, that same day, the mummy was returned to its grave and sealed up tightly, with all guarantees taken that all the excavators and participants in this story remain silent. And when I said my goodbyes to Dr. Ramsay, I felt like I was saying goodbye to a friend. True, I didn't help him much, as usually happened whenever someone requested my expertise, but at least I didn't leave him with the memory of my being a coward or an impostor. At the hospital, Hoveda was still receiving intensive treatment by the psychiatrist Dr. Assam Shalabi, and she was improving. As for her mother, she healed quickly from the shock. I dared once ask my old friend Adil about the things they saw that night, and he told me bitterly, "Don't talk to me about that ever again. Let's just forget it." Was it horrible to that extent? "As long as you live," he replied, "you won't be able to imagine." And here, the psychiatrist came and told me while taking me to Hoveda's room, "You can now talk to her, but gently. What she has seen will never be erased from her mind, but she has a false cover over it." "She was brave," I told him, "and brought what Dr. Ramsay told her to." The load was too heavy on the engine of her soul, and that's why it burnt out. And in the room she lay, surrounded by bouquets of flowers I sent her every day, and she listened to some calm music on the radio and read children's books, for her nerves could no longer bear anything stringent or serious. I sat next to her on the bed, confused, not knowing what to say. "Thank you for the flowers," she said gently, smiling. I reached my hand to light a cigarette, but she pulled it from me, saying, "If it weren't for your smoking, none of this would have happened. And if it weren't for you trying to prevent me from it, none of this would have happened to you." "I don't want a husband who smokes," she murmured. Staring at the ceiling, I said bitterly, "Hoveda, are you sure you want to marry me? You've only seen a very small part of my life, and this is my life's soundtrack, since 1959 up until today. Will you be able to handle this?" Her head tilted so I couldn't see her face, and she went silent for a moment. And when she lifted her face, I understood the truth. She was crying. Crying in that treacherous way in which women always surprise us. Crying when we least expect their tears from what we're saying. And I realized something else. I was in love. For the first time, I loved this miserable, innocent child who loved a lot, and gave all the purity of her soul to me. But I didn't get it, because the werewolves and vampires had occupied all the passages of my soul, so there was no place left for Hoveda. "Hoveda, would you accept?" In silence, is silence the sign of agreement or refusal? I don't remember exactly, but I still will stay with her, no matter what happens. Our wedding day was in May of that same year, but something happened, something I didn't expect, and I didn't realize at all the killer moments it would carry for me. But that's another story. Cairo, 1992. Signed, Dr. Rifat Ismail. End of part 6 and finale of Legend of the Pharaoh's Curse. We hope you enjoyed the book. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our channel for more upcoming audiobooks.